All right, hello, wine drinking people. Time for more of what I've had to drink yesterday. Our good friends from Gallo Winery were in, and you know, this is a winery that is probably one of the most successful family-owned wineries in the world. Well, the biggest family-owned wine in the world, so I guess you could say the most successful family-owned winery in the world. And, you know, they have a lot of different products that a lot of people don't realize they're Gallo because they only have their name, I think, on four wines now. And I'll never forget when I worked at Cafe Max in the early 90s when the Gallo Estate wines came out and the Gallo family said, we are going to put our names only on our top wines. We're going to take them off all this grocery store crap, the Gallo Hardy Burgundies, the Chablis, the 1.5-liter jugs with the screw-on caps. We're going to change that to Livings and Cellars, and we're only going to reserve our name for our best bottles. And I just laughed my ass off when I heard that, you know, in the early 90s. And I said, who the hell is going to pay $100 for a bottle of Gallo Cabernet on our wine list? And at that time, that's what we would have had to charge for it, $100. And we pretty much, yeah, laughed when the rep came in to sell it to us. And then, you know, they came back and said, look, we got a party of eight coming in this Friday night that's going to drink only Gallo wines. I said, all right, send me a case of each. And sure enough, the Gallo group continued to come in and drink the rest of those wines. And they've struggled really with the wines with their own name on. I'm not talking about struggling making great wines. This is a family that has the resources to make some of the best wines in the world. And their Gallo Estate wines were incredible wines, but they just had that stigma of Gallo. Fast forward 20 years ahead in time, and well, the Gallo family, even all those people that are just born, still, I think, don't realize maybe Gallo was a jug wine at one time, but all of us old wine consumers, not that old, am I, still remember the days of Gallo and Hardy Burgundy. So these wines, I think, you know, even though they've changed the package, they've dressed it up a little bit. There's no more Laguna Ranch Chardonnay. Well, the Laguna Ranch they still own, but it goes into this wine along with the Del Rio fruit, but a completely different package, really sharp looking, still has the Gallo name on it. Trying to get over that stigma may be a little tough for us old-timers. All right, well, only 122 barrels of this made, so they could probably drink it all, the Gallo family and their extended family. Good amount of ripe tree fruit here, peaches, apricots, notes of vanilla bean, creme brulee, luscious and ripe on the palate, lovely creamy texture, little butterscotch and vanilla notes here as well, and really a lot of juicy fruit here, but nice balance in this wine, too. Good freshness and a nice touch of oak on the finish. Excellent juice for $30. And then the signature Pinot from the Olson Vineyard in the Santa Lucia Highlands, one of the greatest areas in California for Pinot. Only 91 barrels produced of this wine. Dark cherry and rhubarb-like fruit here, really rich. The host of brown spice, taking on almost some meaty notes on the second day. Fresh floral highlights, really nice complexity. Smooth and silky texture on the tongue. One of the things we love about Pinot Noir, it's sexy. And this wine's got a lot of that red berry fruit. Nice freshness here through the finish and some pretty floral notes there as well. Excellent bottle of Pinot Noir. Surprise. $30 also. And then the Cabernet Sauvignon, which is a blend of Atlas Peak fruit from Wilson, William Hill, and Monte Rosso, which this wine has a lovely dark currant and black cherry fruit. 7% Petit Verdot in the blend. You get a little that floral note from that in there. Very well-endowed bouquet here. Lots of spice, tobacco, cigar box, and earth notes. Really nice complexity here. This wine got a lot of dark berry fruit on the tongue with dark currant, cassis, and fresh earth, spice. Very big, but still has elegance, and you really notice the terroir in this wine, the minerality. Excellent juice. Again, at $34.50, all three Gallo wines, the wines with Gallo on their label, really excellent juice. William Hill is a winery that they purchased after, well, it got purchased by Alec Domecq, I think, in 94, and then Brown-Forman or another big company bought it, and then William Hill purchased it in the early part of, I think, 2002 or 2003. A beautiful winery up on Atlas Peak. William Hill, one of the pioneers of planting vineyards in Napa Valley. And this Chardonnay, I mean, even though the labels have changed, and they've got a little silver label one that's by the glass that's Central Coast, and this one is gold, that's the only difference. The wines are very different. Let me tell you, Napa Valley Chardonnay versus Central Coast Chardonnay, very different flavor profile. This one has a good amount of juicy fruit in the nose, a hint of banana, the tropical note showing there with some creme brulee, smooth and creamy texture on the tongue with a good amount of ripe, juicy fruit, hints of vanilla spice, a real crowd pleaser style, very good juice at $24. The Merlot Estate, this is 100% Estate from that Atlas Peak property, 6% Zinfandel in the blend. What the hell? Petite Syrah, a little Petite Verdot, a good amount of ripe, delicious red berry and cherry fruit on the nose, some sweet tobacco spice, dark chocolate, raspberry fruit here, nice, forward, and enticing bouquet of aromas here. A lot of dark and rich, dark cherry and plum fruit on the tongue with smooth, silky tannins. Merlot is more like in the front of their mouth than the back of the mouth. It doesn't have quite the dry tannins that Cabernet Sauvignon does. A lot of that milk chocolate and cigar box spice showing through the finish, along with that red berry fruit. Really excellent. Very good bottle of Merlot, $28.50. Then the Cabernet Sauvignon Estate, 2008. Unfortunately, 2008 is a little bit late. 2010 is the current release. They don't have any of this to sell, but it was a very good bottle. I figured we should at least share it with you. A lot of dark earth, black spice, pepper, clove, and dark cherry, currant, berry, fruit. Really well-endowed bouquet. A hint of eucalyptus here as well, and tobacco. Really smooth and polished wine on the tongue. These 2008s really showing a little bit of evolution already, and a nice depth of flavor, some dark earth and spice. An excellent bottle at $37.50. Then the Louis Martini Cabernet. This is another landmark winery that these guys have purchased, and resurrecting a great name. Louis Martini, one of the four original wineries in Napa Valley, and like I said, a legendary figure in the Napa Valley, Mr. Martini. This wine's got a big currant cassis berry fruit on the nose, cigar box spice, fine herbs, good hand of fresh plowed earth and dark spices here. Rich and fruity on the tongue with, you know, a lot of that dark berry fruit, some fine tannins. This wine is really well built. This 2010 vintage, built to last, and a firm hand of acidity in there, holding things in place, echoing that nuance of the nose through the finish. Excellent juice at $25.50. That's what we had to drink with our friends from Gallo. I'm your host, Andrew Lampasoni, signing off for the Wine Watch, saying, remember, always drink the good stuff first.